Hello, my wonderful viewer. How are you? I pray that you're keeping well. My name is Didi Owiti. Welcome back. And I'm so glad that you're watching. And if you're new here, please consider subscribing. We are continuing with the discussion on the names of God. And bringing this series to you has been such a blessing and an interesting journey. And we have said that God's names reveal who He is. And so we don't just want to hear about God, we want to know God. It's one thing to read about God, but it's another to experience Him. And just like the people in the Bible, we find ourselves in situations that require divine intervention and God showing up to meet the needs in those situations and revealing Himself to us. And so studying the names of God is reminding us who He is and what He is capable of doing in our lives. Now, this week we are looking at the name Nisi. Or Nisi, depending on where you come from. The Old Testament was originally written in Hebrew before being translated to other languages. And Nisi is in Hebrew. Its translation in English means "the Lord is my banner." Now, banners have been used throughout history and they were commonly used in ancient armies. And they would be carried at the head of the army or they would be planted on a high hill. And this banner served as a rallying point for troops before battle or as an announcement of victory already won. We see it in international games like the Olympics where athletes wave the flags showing the nations they represent. How did this name come about? We find this story in the scriptures in Exodus chapter 17. Now, Moses is the man that God has chosen to rescue the Israelites from Egypt. And he has done just that. He's leading them through the wilderness and they are on their way to the promised land. And then they encounter the Amalekites. Now, the Amalekites were the first enemy to attack the Israelites as they headed to the promised land. Now, Amalek was the nation's founder, a grandson of Esau. And Amalek did not fear God. So this is what happens. Moses asks Joshua to choose some men and to go and fight the Amalekites. Meanwhile, Moses goes on top of a hill with the rod of God in his hand, and he goes with Aaron, his brother, and Hur. Remember, this rod that Moses is lifting up is the same rod that God turned into a snake at the burning bush, the same one that ushered in the plagues in Egypt, and also the one that opened up the Red Sea. And this rod is a reminder to Moses of how a supernatural and all-powerful God can do amazing things through ordinary people and through ordinary resources. So here is what's happening. Moses is up there on the mountain holding up the rod, and Joshua and his men are fighting the Amalekites. When Moses held up his hand, the Israelites were winning. When he lowered it, the Amalekites would win. And he was growing tired, so Aaron and Hur put a stone under him, which he sat on. And then Aaron went on one side of Moses and Hur on the other. And then they held up his hands, and the hands remained steady until sunset. And Joshua defeated the Amalekites. Now, after this glorious victory, Moses built an altar on that hill, and he called it "The Lord is my banner." It was a memorial of God's protection and power. What's the application of this in our lives? The first one, you have an enemy. We face an enemy that is intent on destroying God's plans and purposes in our lives. That enemy is the devil. In the story we've just looked at, the Amalekites wanted to stop the Israelites from going into the promised land. In the same way, the enemy is not just going to watch you succeed, he's going to try to stop you. And he uses people to attack us. The same way that God uses people to bless us and to open doors for us, is the same way the enemy will use people to discourage you, to hurt you, to block doors that you should walk through. The enemy will drive a wedge between husband and wife, between parents and their children, even within the Church of Christ. And the sad part is that we fight people because we think that people are our enemy. In order for you to overcome your enemy, it's important that you know them. It's important that you know your real enemy, the one that is at the root of your conflicts and your frustrations. We are not each other's enemy. The real enemy is the devil. The Bible says that we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. And so it's so important for us to trust God, to know that He has promised that He will defeat our enemy. The enemy will not have the final say in our lives. Yes, he will attempt to fight us, but he will not succeed. Submit to God, resist the enemy, and he will flee. The next one is pray and then act. Now, hard situations come into our lives, and most of the time, we are not able to fix those on our own. We respond in two ways, in prayer and in action. Now, Moses went up the hill to seek God's intervention while Joshua was fighting the battles. Sometimes when we find ourselves in hard situations, we do one thing. We pray about it, and that's it. So you're asking God to help you pass your exams, but you're not studying. You're not putting in the work. You're praying for a job, and you need to be filling in job applications and speaking to people. But instead, you are spending your time on the internet, browsing the internet, trolling people on social media. Maybe you're trusting God to help you in that conflict in your marriage. And you sit back and you're waiting for God to just fix it. My friend, you'll wait until the cows come back home. God is waiting on you to work on yourself, to deal with your pride, to be humble, to be kind. God is waiting on you to apologize for hurting your spouse. Maybe God is waiting on you to forgive your spouse. So you see, prayer without action will not help you. And then we have the other extreme where it is all action and no prayer. You are totally dependent on yourself. You're not dependent on God. And so we lean on our own understanding. We look to our skills, our strength, our resources to overcome what we are facing. We must realize that God has his part to play and we have our part to play. We cannot shift our responsibilities to God and we cannot shift God's responsibilities to us. And the third and last one, we all need an Aaron and a Hur. Aaron and Hur's job was to support Moses' hands, and we should find our own Aaron and our own Hur. When we become weary in life, when you want to give up, when you want to throw in the towel, someone can come alongside us, lift us up, encourage us, and keep us connected to God. No man is an island. God created relationships where we can support each other and do life together. And instead of us spending so much time criticizing one another, we should spend more time encouraging and building each other. And also, God uses people to send us help in the midst of our issues. In conclusion, the Lord our banner means that God is our personal source of new strength and inspiration to press on and to experience victory in our life's battles. My prayer is that you will experience Yahweh Nissi in your life. Keep going, never give up. Your best days are ahead of you, and you will overcome. I thank you for watching. Stay safe, and I will see you next time.